Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Evil Woman by Julie Mulhern. Narrated by Callie Beaulieu. Chapter 1. June 1975. Kansas City, Missouri. I stumbled into the kitchen, spotted Mr. Coffee's near full pot, and offered him a grateful smile. I missed you more than words could say. He preened and sat taller on the counter. Welcome home. How was Italy? Fabulous. Magical. Best trip ever. Except for the coffee. Cappuccino is good, but try ordering one after 10 o'clock in the morning. If the waiter deigns to serve you, he does it with a sneer. Italians drink espresso after 10. It's too strong, and I can't wrap my hands around a demi-tasse. I took a mug from the cabinet and wrapped my fingers around it. Well, you're home now. How are you feeling? Jet lag? Mr. Coffee was always so concerned with my well-being. A bit. It never lasts long. Right now, I need coffee. I poured dark brown nectar into the mug and added cream. Ellison? I tipped up a finger. Just a minute. Some might think it odd I had a first-name relationship with my coffee maker, but during my first marriage, Mr. Coffee was the man on whom I depended. There's nothing like the first sip. Ellison. Whatever he wanted to tell me would keep for 10 seconds. I raised the cup to my lips, took a large sip, and sprayed bitter, cold coffee across the counter. To his credit, Mr. Coffee didn't laugh, but he did observe a highly suspicious silence. I took those seconds to blot coffee from the front of my robe. Are you broken? A hint of hysteria tinged my voice. Is there a Mr. Coffee fixer? Maybe that dishwasher repairman from TV can fix you, the one who complains he has nothing to do. I'm not broken. Oh, thank God. Then why is the coffee cold? Your new husband pushed my button hours ago. Anarchy did this to me? The honeymoon was over. And my burner goes cool after 2 hours. Anarchy hadn't realized I'd sleep so late. Even so, we could have emptied the pot, refilled the reservoir, and added grounds. I did all those things now. Then I pushed Mr. Coffee's button. While the coffee brewed, I wiped down the kitchen counter. Did we miss much while we were gone?
Not here.
Mr. Coffee, with his yellow gingham face and access to endless caffeine, had a naturally sunny nature, but he sounded almost snarky. Boring without me. Dull as decaf. Dull can be good. Dull meant I didn't find any bodies. Dull meant no one tried to kill me. Dull is dull. Dull is restful.
If you say so.
He didn't agree, but refused to argue with me. I love that about him. Ding dong. I glanced toward the front hall. Libba or mother?
Your mother wouldn't bother with the bell.
True. I gathered the folds of my soiled bathrobe, tightened its belt, and stared longingly at Mr. Coffee's near full pot.
Answer the door. The coffee will be ready in minutes.
Ding dong. Max, our Weimaraner with plans for world domination, lifted his head from his paws. He was peeved. With me. I'd left him at home. If I'd taken him to Italy, he might have conquered the Veneto. Or Rome. Ding dong. I'm coming, I muttered. Max joined me in the hallway. His stubby tail even wagged. Am I forgiven? He lifted his doggy nose and trotted past me. Not forgiven. Not even close. Forgiveness would cost me doggy treats, extra walks, and an hour-long scratch behind his silky ears. I yanked the door open. Oh, good, you're awake. I stared at my best friend. Do you have any idea what time it is?
Do you?
I didn't.
We got home at 2 this morning.
After a full day of travel, she peered over my shoulder. Is Anarchy still sleeping? Anarchy got up early and went to the station. My conscience twinged. I couldn't hold cold coffee against him. Not when he was at his desk while I slept. And Grace, where's Grace? My daughter had padded downstairs when we arrived home, offered us sleepy hugs, and explained her exhausting schedule. 2 days for swim team, plus an extra hour of laps if she wanted a spot as an A swimmer. Then babysitting for a toddler who never slowed down. She'd hear about Italy later. Dead on my feet, I'd promised the extra suitcase we'd picked up in Florence held multiple surprises, then toddled off to bed. She's at swim team. Lippa pushed into the foyer and wrapped me in a warm hug. I missed you. Tell me everything. We shopped, we ate good food, we drank great wine, and we looked at great art. That cobbler's shop in Milan? When I mentioned great art, I meant Michelangelo's David, but the cobbler was also an artist. There's a slight chance I went a bit overboard, but a woman could never own too many boots, even if she had to wait till autumn to wear them. What else? We wandered lemon groves. Libba rolled her eyes. You got out of bed for lemons? Anarchy's doing something wrong. Or you are. Her grin was especially naughty. Tell me and we'll figure it out. Libba was not getting bedroom details. We watched the sunset from the patio of a Tuscan villa. If our places were reversed, I'd tell you everything. And I'd plug my ears. Not that I'd want to hear it, she pouted. Oh, you're no fun. But you missed me, despite my stick-in-the-mud ways. I led her to the kitchen, poured her a cup of coffee, and at long last filled my mug. What happened while I was gone? Prudence Davies' mother is dead. I figured she'd make it to 100. Mean women live forever. What happened? A knowing smile curled Libba's lips. There's a rumor. About? Muriel didn't die of natural causes. Who killed her? My mind settled on the obvious suspect. Prudence? Who else? Prudence. A killer. Really? I closed my eyes and considered. No one would blame Prudence for killing her mother. Muriel ranked among the most unpleasant people I'd ever met, and I included in that count numerous murderers and Prudence who'd had a torrid affair with my late husband. Is there an investigation? Libba nodded. You know what this means. Well, Prudence may go to prison. I didn't pretend sadness. I barely refrained from dancing a jig, but only because I might spill my coffee. No, well, yes. More importantly, someone in our circle died and you didn't swim into, trip over, or even discover the body. I had a deplorable habit of finding the newly dead. The back door opened and Aggie, the woman who took care of me and my daughter Grace and now Anarchy, bustled into the kitchen. She carried 2 grocery bags and wore an orange caftan with turquoise flowers. The hem and the cuffs sported turquoise pom-poms. She smiled when she saw us. You're up! I took a bag from her arms and set it on the counter. I'm up. Should I make fresh coffee? I just made a pot. I should have started a new one before I left. Libba frowned at us. What's the problem? Mrs. Jones likes to come downstairs to hot coffee. And? And this morning I came down to a cold pot. Aggie and Mr. Coffee winced. Libba rubbed the pat of her thumb over her bent pointer finger. The world's saddest song on the world's smallest violin. It's a little thing. Anarchy and I will work it out. He can refill the grounds and reservoir mornings when he leaves early. I tightened my hold on my coffee mug. We'd been home less than 12 hours, and already there was a hiccup. Marriage was going to be an adjustment for both of us. I pulled a bottle of cream from the grocery bag and put it in the fridge. Libba just told me Prudence Davies is a suspect in her mother's murder. How did she die? Asked Aggie, a question I should have asked. Suffocated.
How awful.
Aggie took celery stalks from the sack and put them next to the sink for washing. Libba flashed a ghoulish grin. Would you expect anything less than awful from Prudence? Aggie chuckled. Good point. Are there any other suspects? She pulled a box of raisin bran from the sack. I pointed at the box. What's that? Aggie glanced at the cereal in her hand and her brow creased as if I'd asked a trick question. Raisin bran? I see that. Why is it in my house? Detective Jones likes raisin bran? He does. I married a man who eats raisins? You're sure? Aggie covered her mouth with her hand as if she were hiding a smile. When I told him I was marketing today, he asked me to buy some. I grabbed the counter and lowered myself to a stool. Raisins? Ellison hates raisins. Libba grinned as if she found raisins amusing. She hates them with a passion most people reserve for their archenemies. Take a perfectly good grape and let it shrivel and rot. Aggie frowned. Rot might be a bit strong. I cut off Aggie's raisin defense with a wave of my hand. They're infested with insect eggs. That's not true, said Libba. It is, I insisted. I read it in the paper. Raisins are awful, and they'd soon be on a shelf in my pantry. Libba chuckled. First, your new husband drank your coffee, then he asked for raisins. What's next? Grapes in the chicken salad? I glanced at the celery, then skewered Aggie with a severe look, so she knew I meant business. That is my line in the sand. Grapes do not belong in chicken salad. I'm sure Aggie could dice them. I turned my look on Libba. Don't you have someplace else to be? Nope. She popped the pea and grinned. What did you bring me from Italy? You don't deserve a gift. She stuck out her tongue. Of course I do. Is it something good? I'd been looking forward to giving Libba and Aggie their gifts, but I pretended reluctance. They were part of the raisin conspiracy. Fine. You two stay here. I'll be right back. I ran up the back stairs and dashed into the blue guest bedroom where Anarchy and I had left our bulging suitcases. I rifled through four before I found the scarf box that held Libba's gift and the bag that held Aggie's. I grabbed both and returned to the kitchen. Libba's gaze landed on the box and she rubbed her hands together. Is that what I think it is? I don't know. It was. I handed over the box, and she ripped off the top. Her eager fingers ripped through the logoed tissue paper, and she pulled the silk twill scarf from its box. It's gorgeous. Thank you. You're welcome. The saleswoman promised that pattern is not yet available in America. I handed the bag to Aggie. I hope you like it. She pulled out a caftan in a geometric poochie print in harvest gold, cream, brown, burnt sienna, and avocado. The slightly fitted sleeves ended above the elbow and were finished with 12 inches of harvest gold fringe. Her smile wobbled and she stroked the fabric. It's beautiful. Too pretty to wear. Don't be silly, said Libba. Mac will love you in that. Mac was Aggie's boyfriend and the owner of a delicatessen and catering company. Pink touched Aggie's cheeks and she held up the new caftan so its vibrant fabric covered her orange and turquoise. You think? I'm sure of it, Libba replied. Thank you, Ellison. You're welcome. I'm glad you like it. I stood and refilled my coffee mug. Should I make another pot? Such a silly question. Please, bring, bring. We all stared at the phone as if it had just grown horns and hefted a pitchfork, but only I spoke. Mother, chances are good. Libba's voice had a laissez-faire quality that put me on edge. Aggie pitched up the receiver. Joan's residence. I'm sorry, she's not available. Yes, she's home. She arrived early this morning. I'll let her know you called. She winced and hung up. Mother, I asked. If so, Aggie deserved a raise. No. Aggie shook her head and her orange curls bounced like springs. I thought you might want more coffee before you spoke with her. With whom? Prudence Davies. Libba narrowed her eyes and tapped a finger on her pursed lips. Gee, I wonder what she wants. You don't think she'd call me for help? Yes, Libba and Aggie spoke in unison. She hates me. For reasons known only to Prudence, she behaved as if I'd infringed on her relationship with Henry, as if she were the injured party. Libba snorted. The woman is desperate, and you're married to a homicide detective. Had Prudence truly committed matricide? If so, why? Sure, I'd considered murdering Mother, especially when she pushed me toward Hunter Taft, a lawyer who'd shown an interest after my late husband's murder, but at the end of the day, I loved her. Mother, more than anyone, was in my corner. Tell me what happened. It happened last weekend. Libba slid a stack of mail across the counter and scrutinized a catalog cover. At Muriel's house? Prudence lived with her mother a few blocks from me. Yes. She rejected the catalog and flipped through my unopened mail. Was anyone else at home? No. And Muriel was definitely suffocated. That's what Jinx says. Our friend Jinx was a world-class gossip who seldom got her facts wrong. Libba held up a large blue envelope. Are you going? What is it? She handed over the envelope addressed to Mr. and Mrs. Anarchy Jones. Sarah and August Elmhurst are having a cocktail party. Are you going? I don't know when it is or if Anarchy's available, I hedged. On the one hand, this was the first invitation addressed to both me and Anarchy. On the other, it was a party at Sarah's. I liked Sarah, but she didn't eat. No one had witnessed a bite of food crossing her lips in 6 years. Well, aside from the olives in her martinis. And because she didn't actually eat, the food at her parties was abysmal. Cocktail weenies, meatballs in a god-awful goop made from grape jelly and chili sauce, and Polynesian kebabs, sausage, pineapple, and water chestnuts marinated in honey and sauce. I'll ask him. We could go to dinner beforehand, Libba suggested. I grabbed a knife from the drawer, slid open the invitation, and frowned. It's this Saturday. It'll be fun. Dinner, I mean. I haven't had Chinese in ages. We'll go to that place on the plaza. House of Toy? Tempting. But there was no way she'd pressure me into attending this party. Not until Anarchy understood the ramifications of inedible food and generous pours of expensive liquor. Rather than argue, I changed the subject. I'm guessing things are still going well with Charlie? Libba had recently taken up with my newly divorced next-door neighbor. Yes, she pulled at the collar of her blouse. Back to Prudence. Do you think she has it in her to commit murder? Apparently, two could change the subject. She had the opportunity. They lived in the same house. Also, it's Prudence. She's a terrible person. And then there's Muriel. That Prudence didn't kill her mother before now is a miracle. Libba opened a catalog. So that's it? What do you mean? You won't investigate? I frowned. Me? She looked up from a page filled with dresses. You. I didn't like Muriel. I don't like Prudence. For once, I didn't find the body, and it's none of my business. That's a no? That's a no. Probably. Was the house locked for the night? Asked Aggie. Yes. Libba tapped a blue linen dress with a lacquered nail. But Jinx says their hidden key is missing. Hidden under a flower pot, I asked. Worse, under the welcome mat. I'd given up hiding a key outside when a killer used it to enter my house. Aggie, did you have house keys made for Anarchy? He took them with him this morning. Thank you. Libba dog-eared my catalog, then picked up a bright pink envelope. You're invited to the Dawson's couple shower for Summer Hagewood and her fiancé. It's nice having you here. I don't have to open my mail. Not my fault we're invited to the same parties. What was the time of death? I asked. Libba smirked. How's not investigating going? Bring... Bring! Aggie reached for the phone, and I topped off my coffee mug, then held up the pot. Libba covered her mug with her palm. Jones residence! Aggie placed her pointer finger on her lips, and Libba and I fell silent. Good morning, Mrs. Walford. No, I'm sorry, she's not up yet. Aggie paled. Yes, Libba is here. She's having coffee and waiting for Mrs. Jones to wake up. Aggie's face tightened as if Mother had imparted terrible news. Then she nodded. I'll tell her. No one uttered a sound until the receiver was safely back in its cradle. How did Frances know I was here? Libba demanded. Is she psychic? Marion Dixon, I replied. It was a safe guess. My across-the-street neighbor was always nosy, but since I started finding bodies, watching my house had become her favorite hobby. And she reports to your mother? I gave her a grim nod. At least once a day. More often, if anything interesting happens. What does Mother want, Aggie? You're to call her, and she expects you, Detective Jones and Grace, for dinner. I resisted, burying my head in my hands. Tonight? Aggie's face tightened in an apologetic grimace. Don't shoot the messenger. Look on the bright side, said Libba. There's a bright side? I couldn't see one. She can't be mad at you for finding Muriel's body. You developed a sense of humor while I was gone. Chapter 2. The sun was perfect, and the pool deck smelled of coconut suntan lotion, chlorine, and heat. I closed my eyes behind my sunglasses and considered a nap. In the pool, children splashed, boys played gutter ball, and every so often a lifeguard blew his whistle and yelled at an intrepid youngster to stay off the lane ropes. At regular intervals, the lifeguard at the towel desk called a teenager to the telephone. The noises were familiar, even soothing. Three girls, perhaps a year younger than Grace, lounged in chairs 15 feet from mine. Their skin glistened with baby oil and iodine, and they chattered about David Cassidy, the latest issue of a teen magazine, and how many limes they liked in their tabs. A contented sigh slipped past my lips. 1,000 chores waited for me at home. Unpack, return umpteen phone messages, reply to 6 invitations, pay bills, call Jinx and get the skinny on Prudence. But after calling Mother and telling her we could not come to dinner, she was not pleased, I'd turn my back on my to-do list and escape to the pool. This afternoon, a chaise lounge next to glistening water was exactly what I needed. Ellison? I turned my head, opened my eyes, and reconsidered my choices. Sarah Elmhurst, who wore a tiny bikini, smiled down at me. May I join you? Without waiting for an answer, she dropped a pool bag onto the chaise next to mine and put her iced tea on the table between us. When did you get back from Italy? Early this morning. I wanted time to relax and recharge without making conversation. Also, I'd eaten my way through Italy, and now a woman so thin she didn't cast a shadow sat next to me. I sucked in my tummy. Was Italy marvelous? I've never been. August and I bought a house in Vail when Weston was little. She pulled a bottle of suntan oil from her bag. It seemed like a fine idea, but August insists we go there every vacation. I love the mountains, I do, but visiting a beach or taking a trip to Europe wouldn't kill us. Anywho, marvelous. She meant Italy. Yes. She angled the chaise so she'd get full sun, unfurled a beach towel, then stretched out. You must be exhausted. I covered a yawn. A bit tired. Did you hear about Muriel Jarrett? Her stage whisper was audible to the whole pool deck and heads turned. I did. So awful. Sarah rubbed oil into skin that was already deeply tanned. I wonder if Prudence will be arrested soon. I could sense ears straining to hear my reply. Even the teenage girls who'd engaged in a spirited argument about which Cassidy brother was better looking fell silent. I haven't the slightest. Sarah's nose wrinkled as if I'd disappointed her. You seem very blasé. I thought you'd be dancing or breaking into song. Did she think we lived in a Broadway musical? True, I'd experienced a schadenfreude moment when Libba told me about Prudence's troubles, but I'd moved past the desire to jig. Muriel is dead. She batted away my point with a wave of her manicured fingers. The woman was as mean as a snake. Even if I'd had the energy to argue, Sarah made a good point. But I'd given the matter some thought. Well, the drive from my house to the club, and I couldn't quite see Prudence as a killer. I can't imagine Prudence murdered her mother. My own mother had provided me with numerous motives for murder, but I'd only considered killing her once or twice, and thinking and doing were very different things. Relationships between mothers and daughters were tricky, even fraught. Mothers saw their daughters as reflections of themselves. Daughters looked for criticism and compliments. Whenever mother told me my hair looked nice, I assumed it was time for a trim. I spent decades living under mother's thumb. I might still be there, but my first husband's death had served as a wake-up call. Did I want to live the life she chose for me, or the one I wanted? I'd done the impossible. I'd made a stand and married the man I loved. She'd fought that decision until the moment Anarchy and I exchanged vows, but now that we were married, she accepted my new husband. At least I hoped she did, and she'd tempered her demands. Yes, she still expected command performance dinners, regular phone calls, the occasional Sunday brunch, and my adherence to the rules of polite society as she understood them. But those were small directives, easily managed or ignored. Didn't Prudence have an affair with your husband? Sarah's question put thoughts of mother clean out of my head and had me lifting my brows above the rims of my glasses. Sarah knew the answer to that question. Why was she asking? With my late husband, not the man I just married, the man who'd investigated my first husband's death. That's who I meant. Henry. It had to hurt. Henry and Prudence? Yes. And I so enjoyed it when people poked the scar. I glanced at my iced tea glass Sadly, still full, I couldn't escape to the snack bar for a refill. What was he thinking? You're a lovely woman. And Prudence? She'd lose a beauty contest with Mr. Ed. What was Sarah's angle? Was her reminder of past sins a way to get me talking? I did not like Prudence at all, but that didn't mean I'd kick her when she was down. What else happened while I was gone? Sarah's brow wrinkled and she crossed her arms beneath her substantial cleavage. I hadn't taken the bait and she was not pleased. Surely something else happened, I insisted. Something scandalous? There was always a scandal brewing. Sarah huffed. The custody battle between Sabra and the tiki bartender got ugly. I blinked. Pardon? You haven't heard? Sarah glanced left and right, presumably looking for eavesdroppers. Finding none, she said, Sabra Davidson went to college in Florida, met some bartender, and married him. Shirley and Dan were beside themselves, but they told no one. Anywho, Sabra got pregnant, had a baby, and then the marriage fell apart. Of course it did. What did the girl expect? That a bartender could keep her in Lily Pulitzer shifts and Bernardo sandals? Sarah shook her head at the foolish dreams of youth. After a few months lived in poverty, Sabra gathered her son and came home. Well, the bartender followed her up here. How awful. How had Shirley and Dan kept this quiet for so long? What happened? The Davidsons hired a private investigator to investigate him. I haven't heard what they found, but I do know the bartender is demanding joint custody and insists that Sabra return to Florida. I wasn't terribly worried about Sabra. Her parents could afford the best lawyers. What a mess. It is, Sarah agreed. I can't imagine how difficult this must be for poor Shirley. Tell me about your trip. Did you taste lots of good wine? We did, and we ate amazing food. She wrinkled her nose at the mention of sustenance. Sarah was a woman convinced she'd hold on to her youth if she held on to her waistline. Her slender body, perky breasts, consensus around the bridge table was she'd had them done, and carefully highlighted hair couldn't hide the truth. Her 20s were a distant memory, her 30s were fading fast, and her 40s were halfway over. Did you meet any interesting people? One. We were sitting at a cafe in Milan, and Anarchy was reading the paper. Anarchy reads Italian? The International Herald Tribune, I clarified. We were drinking coffee, Anarchy was reading, and I was sketching when a man approached us. A movie star. I rolled my eyes behind the cover of my sunglasses. A gallery owner. He'd spotted my sketch and liked it. We ended up having dinner with him and his wife. They were charming. It wasn't until later I realized who he was. Are gallery owners famous? Some are. He is. Lloyd Foster's gallery is one of the most important in London. Well, that's nice. Her voice was flat. Clearly, she'd been hoping for a story about Marcello Mastroianni or Franco Nero or Sophia Loren. I always say a woman needs a hobby. That was rich, coming from a woman whose hobby was counting calories. Art is more of a career. She patted my hand. Of course it is. That's why you're at the pool on a Tuesday afternoon and not in your studio. That Sarah had a point, a small one, made her even more annoying. I forced a smile. That's the wonderful thing about being my own boss. I can take a day off whenever I want. Aren't you just back from a 2-week vacation? I am, with a sketchbook full of ideas. I never know when something, a vista, a person, a street, will trigger an emotional response. When that happens, I make a sketch. There's a pad in my pool bag now. If she wasn't careful, I'd sketch her a size 8, maybe a 10. That reminds me, I'm chairing an auction this fall. Will you donate a canvas? You just called me a hobbyist, she winced. You took it the wrong way. I had no idea you took your art so seriously. If I ate nothing but beef bouillon and gin-soaked olives, I might be as obtuse as Sarah. No, not obtuse. I'd be impossible. Let's go to lunch and discuss it. A frown creased her forehead. I don't eat lunch. Was she worried her husband might trade her in for a newer, skinnier model? It happened to loads of women. Women who went from sipping iced tea poolside to spritzing perfume on unsuspecting shoppers. Can't we discuss it now? I've been home less than a day. Have a show coming up in Chicago and need to inventory the canvases in my studio. I can't promise you anything today, she pouted. But, Ellison, you're back. Why didn't you call me? Jinx, who wore tennis whites, planted her hands on her hips and glared at me as if I were Missy Crandall, her partner who double-faulted to lose the last set in the club championship. Sarah? She ignored. We arrived this morning, and my phone didn't ring? Next time I get home at 2 a.m, I'll call you. You heard about Muriel Jarrett? Yes. And? She eyed me expectantly. You know more than I do. She was suffocated. So I'm told, she tilted her head. Anarchy told you? Libba, and she says you told her. Jinx frowned as if I'd presented her with bad news, as if she hoped for additional sources of information, like a homicide detective. I heard the killer used a bed pillow. Murdered her in her sleep? Jinx drew out sleep, making a statement into a question. Jinx, I truly know nothing. She tapped her pursed lips with her pointer finger and her eyes looked into the distance. Anarchy left for work before I heard about the murder. I haven't spoken to him. She returned her gaze to me. I wonder, did Muriel wake up? If so, the pressure of a pillow held to her face, the inability to breathe, the impossible task of fighting a younger and stronger assailant, younger and stronger, were a safe assumption. Muriel had been older than dirt. Must have been terrifying. Ask your husband. Then tell me what he says was unspoken. If Anarchy shared anything with me and asked me to keep quiet, I wouldn't tell Jinx. Nor anyone else. I offered her a bland smile. She scowled as if she sensed my newfound commitment to discretion. You've heard about Sabra? Sarah just told me. Jinx shifted her gaze and offered Sarah a minuscule nod. What about Elizabeth and Wes Lynn? Elizabeth and Wes were younger than us by 10 years, but Elizabeth sat on 3 committees at the club, was active in the junior league and played decent golf, good tennis, and a mean game of bridge. We liked her. What about them? They adopted a baby. Well, that's wonderful news. Jinx's gaze flitted to Sarah, then returned to me. I'll tell you more later. How was Italy? Favolosa. Did you see anything but the inside of hotel rooms? Next to me, Sarah choked on her tea. Shops, galleries, museums, cafes, restaurants, churches, I could go on. Ellison met a gallery owner, said Sarah. Did you? Jinx's tone was blatantly disinterested. Lloyd Foster, I told her. He runs a gallery in London. She perked up. Does that mean a show in England? Not this year. I wasn't nearly ready for my show in Chicago. In retrospect, I should have spent the day in my studio instead of the pool. Spreading paint on a canvas was far more relaxing than fielding questions about a murder case. You'll be at Bridge tomorrow? Jinx asked. Wouldn't miss it. It's a home meet, but we'll arrive long before the swimmers. A home meet? Problem?
Yes, I declined Mother's dinner invitation for tonight and told her we'd come tomorrow, but Grace will be swimming. Swim meets began at 4, lasted for hours, and finished with a buffet supper. There was no way we could join Mother and Daddy for dinner. I needed to call her as soon as possible. She grimaced on my behalf. "We'll talk at bridge." She turned on her heel and left without having actually spoken to Sarah. "You're at odds?" I asked. Jinx had never liked Sarah, but this was the first time she'd been openly rude. "She got a story wrong. I called a lawyer."
"Jinx? Wrong? What story?"
I waited for her to explain, but Sarah's lips were a thin line and a deep crease cut through her forehead. Whatever the story, she wasn't telling. I made a note to ask about Sarah's story when I saw Jinx. "How's Weston? Is he keeping busy this summer?" Weston, Sarah and August's son, had just finished his freshman year at college. "He's working at the company." August manufactured a part that was essential to the running of cars. "Learning the business. Has he declared a major? Business, with a minor in theater." Chances were excellent that Weston, if left to his own devices, would have majored in theater. But as in...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.